Mr. Browning, you've been conducting these master classes at Northwestern for the last five seasons, is it? And over that time, you have seen quite a come and go, turnover, and continuity in the students. Tell me your impressions so far. This is your sixth year or fifth?
This is my fifth year.
Uh-huh. How do these particular sessions perhaps differ from what you've had before? And how do they complement what you've done at the university?
Well, when I first started out doing the masterclass series, I established in my mind what I... obviously, we want to hear as many of the piano students playing piano solo repertoire as possible, but I also had the idea that I wanted to introduce the students as much as possible to other forms of music making.
Sure.
So, I think the first one I did with another member of the faculty outside of the piano department was with Mr. Marcellus, who was a very old and dear friend. We've known each other 20 years or so, mm-hmm. dating back from even pre-Cleveland days. I've had Dorothy Lane, who was a harpsichordist, participate in the classes. I've had several members of the faculty. This week, of course, we've had Mr. Alderson, the head of the voice department, mm-hmm. and I sat down last night and accompanied some songs just to show the kids that it's not beneath a concert pianist to collaborate with a singer, going back to the recordings of Maggie Tate and Alfred Cortot, Debussy.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, what I want to do is to get the pianist to realize that there is something beyond the 88 keys on the mm-hmm. instrument, and to think in terms of sounds other than the piano. After all, the piano is basically a fake orchestra,
mm-hmm.
and it does not have a natural bel canto. It does not have a natural legato. Mm-hmm. The hammer strikes, and the sound diminishes immediately. So we have to fake a real singing quality. We have to fake color. We have to go outside of the instrument to get the color and the sound and the legato that we have been deprived of by the nature of the instrument. Mm-hmm. Whereas a wind instrument or a violin or a voice has the sustaining ability that we don't have.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What's interesting of particularly to me about the framework of these master classes is that you don't limit your instruction just to piano students. You bring them exposure to voice, to various musical
right.
and accompanimental frameworks. Is this unique in your experience?
I'll be honest, simply in the respect that I don't know of any other program like it in the country. There may be, but I don't know personally of any other university that is putting on a regular series of master classes by one person.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I come here three times a year for five classes each time,
mm-hmm.
each quarter. It was set up by Dean Miller and myself to... Well, actually, it just kind of evolved. Having been a friend of Mr. Marcellus, of course, I visited them here, and then suddenly Dean Miller talked to me about the possibility of my participating in the faculty, and bit by bit we evolved this concept.
Mm-hmm. How do the students interact with each other? You know, that's certainly one of the strengths of the masterclass situation, in that students are free to give feedback to each other, and it isn't just a student-pupil relationship.
Well, one of the interesting factors, of course, is the fact that very often what I say in class will appear to be very different from what their major teacher says, and apparently this can be confusing. I'm sure it was for me years ago, and it still is sometimes. Just as, you as a critic will know this, we get different reviews in a city for the same concert, and you wonder, you know, what really happened.
Sometimes from the same critic over
right,
a period of time.
Right. the teacher will tell them one thing and I may say another thing, and many times we may in fact disagree, but many times we're simply expressing the same thing in a different way. So what they get used to, hopefully out of these classes, is the fact that not only do musicians have different ways of expressing themselves, but very good musicians can disagree.
Sure.
And the disagreement is part of the game. There is no such thing as a unanimous verdict in music making.